Hello everybody, am I audible? Okay, so let's talk sharding, past, present and future. So what is sharding? Sharding,
I can hear it, it's just not high enough.
Is it any better now?
No.
No?
People just don't, you need to be a little more silent.
Now? No?
It is actually working.
Is it actually on?
I think it is. Yeah.
Okay. Let's clip it higher. Clip it up to the collar.
Even more. Okay.
Clip it on your shirt. That might actually work.
Okay. Now?
Yeah, that's much better. Clip it to your right side.
Sorry?
You can put it on the side because you'll be looking over at the slides.
Oh, okay. Makes sense. Okay, so what is sharding? Sharding is a new translator we introduced in 370. It was born out of a need to solve problems associated with storing large files on Gluster. So I'm going to finish the past and the future part really fast. Probably I would like to spend more time on the present. So let's get started. Okay, yeah, I must admit there is no past as such to sharding because it was only introduced in 370 and it has remained that way ever since. Probably I'll take the liberty of calling striping as the past to sharding, since anyway it is the predecessor to sharding. So let's see what striping is. So striping is a client-side translator that sits below DHT. So it would split your file into block-sized chunks, not physically but logically. And when you create your volume, you can basically specify your stripe count. For example, if you have a stripe count of 3, you would have 3 bits on which your file will be striped. So let's say you have in the 3 stripe count 3 scenario, it would chunk your file into the block size that you specify, and it is spread across multiple piece files in a round robin fashion. So it doesn't physically break the file, it just knows where to write, which file to write to based on the offset and the size. So I'll just show a picture which probably explains what striping does. So here I have an unstriped file on the left. So they are all equal sized blocks which you can configure. And let's say it's, 4 MB is the block size. So when you have a stripe count of 3, your first 4 MB would be written to the first subvolume, the copy of the same file in the first subvolume. As it grows and crosses the 4 MB mark, you see the same, the next bytes written on the next subvolume, and so on in a round robin fashion. So that's what striping does. So why are we not going ahead with striping as a solution to our large file problems? One of the issues is that you can only add servers in multiples of stripe count times replica count. So that is going to increase the cost of your setup. And and the second thing is that the splitting of the file is not granular enough. So if you see, even if I have a say 3 TB file and if it is striped, I still need to have 1 TB of that file in every break, which is not really reducing the size of the file for easy manageability. So yeah, and what are the repercussions of this? One thing, self-heal, which is one of the main pain points with our users, it would still have to heal total file size divided by stripe count bytes of data. Even if a few bytes of the file change while a brick was down, you have to heal one full file, I mean, in this example, if it's a 3 TB file, again, you'll have to probably heal 1 TB of data, which consumes a lot of resources and CPU, etc. And another example would be a geo replication of a striped file would again have to sync the same amount of data. So I think you can apply that for pretty much all other features. So I'm just picking self-heal and geo replication. So the other reason is that the utilization of the disks is still suboptimal. You cannot make use of all the space you have in your volume. So if you have an XTB sized file, you would require at least XTB divided by stripe count amount of space available as the file grows. So this also implies that the distribution of your I/O load is not really all that, it's not distributed well. So it's still confined to those three bricks. They have to take all the load. So then we came up with sharding. So at the moment, sharding is only supported for VM image storage. So why VM image storage? Because it is a typical large file use case. And the second thing is that according to this survey that Amy had done, I think it was last year, about 42% of our users actually use Gluster to store VM images. And I think most of us know how many problems they ran into with Selfie. I think Joe would know. Okay, so what is sharding? This is again a client-side Xlator, except that it sits above DHT. So it splits the file into equal sized chunks as it grows in size. But these chunks are physically broken, and we have different files for storing each of these chunks. So only the zeroth shard would be under its normal parent directory, and the rest, as the file grows and crosses the 4M boundary in this example, we would create a new file under a hidden dot shard directory that we do not expose to the application. So this directory is present on all the bricks, and the subsequent shards are named after the GFID of the original file dot the block number. So if as the file crosses the 4M boundary, so if my GFID is some ABCD, then the first block would be GFID.1 and then GFID.2 and so on. So translators above sharding will only see the files created by the application, and translators that sit below shard in the stack will see all the remaining shards as if they are normal files. And the shard size is configurable at volume level. You can have it anywhere between 4 MB and 4 TB. So this probably would explain things better. So in the stack, we have sharding sitting above DHT. So when a write comes with the FD offset and size, depending on these three pieces of information, it can decide as to what block it would be writing to. So it will create that block file if it does not exist already, and then send the write. And the creation will first reach DHT. For DHT, it is as if it is any other file. So DHT takes the responsibility of distributing the file based on its hashing algorithm and other parameters like minfree disk and minfree inodes, etc. So I have a demo here that would probably explain this better. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So we start yesterday first. And we create a simple plane distribute volume with three sub-volumes. Enable sharding. So the block size is at its default, which is 4 MB. Start the volume. So I create a fuse mount of the volume at /mnt. So now I write 41 MB of data into the file. Okay, so when we go to the bricks, we see that the first file or the zeroth file is actually hashed to the first brick, that is where it resides. So we have the GFID of the file, which is 1C81. Just remember that. So that's the blocks. Shard block size is the extractor which contains the 4 MB property of the file, and the file size, the aggregated file size, is actually stored in the form of an extractor again. The part on the left, the 29 that you see, that's the file size. And the 15168 thing is the block count, the aggregated block count. Okay, now I do ls on the dot shard directory of all the three bricks. And so we start counting from 1, and we see that it's distributed across all the three bricks. So the last, only the last shard, which is the 10th shard, is 1 MB, because we did a 41 MB file. So 4 times 10 plus 1 MB. So yeah. Okay, on the mount point, when we do an LS, the size would show as 41 MB, which actually means that it is the exciter that we stored from which we fetch the aggregated size and present to the application. So that's about the demo. Okay, so how does sharding benefit the VM storage use case? So one of the pain points is data self-heal for a really large file. So if you have a 20 TB VM image, even if you change 1 GB of data while a brick was down, you have to basically heal the whole file, which means to read from the source brick, read blocks 128K, is it? Yeah, 128K blocks from the source brick, 128K blocks from the sync brick, compute the checksum, see whether they match. If they don't, then heal that part and then go ahead with the next 128 blocks and so on until you reach the end of file, which is resource intensive, and it also takes a really long time. So in that time, if another brick goes down, then most likely you will see split brain, or your HA would be lost, maybe because of quorum loss. So this is one of the main pain points that we hear from the users. This is probably the second point, is a more generic point about how all the other features benefit when you reduce the size of the file. And the third point is that your VM image size no longer is limited by the capacity of the individual bricks. So if you need a 1 TB file that you want to write to your volume, and let's say the brick where it hashes does not have 1 TB of space left. Because of sharding, you can actually break it into pieces, so the other two, the remaining shards will actually be distributed across the rest of the bricks, so it will be uniformly distributed. So yeah, the fourth point is the IO across the bricks will also be better distributed, so you don't have to choke one brick to death because of a lot of IO. So the last point is you can add bricks only after existing brick space is fully utilized, so you can rest assured that all your spaces, all the bricks have been utilized fully before you add new bricks, so you don't have to waste space in the older bricks. So we asked the users to try this, and the result was this. I must particularly mention one user called Lindsay Matheson, who did a lot of help by testing this for us pretty much from the time sharding was introduced, when it was barely working. So I think sharding was released about around the time of summit last year, I think Gluster Summit, right after the Gluster Summit, and that too it was in experimental state. So because of Lindsay's help, we got it to be stabilized over every 3.7x release, and now I think it's pretty much stable. So we also have, I think Lindsay is using it in production, if I understand correctly, and at least from my interactions with the other users, I know that there are at least two more guys who are using sharding in production. So I guess we've come a long way from where we started. So some questions you might have about this. Where are all the metadata associated with the original file stored? So we basically store everything on the zeroth shard. I call it the base file here. So what would that include? File permissions, ownership, the aggregated file size and block count, as we already saw, and even the user set extended attributes. And shards under dot shard are owned by root. So dot shard itself, the brick creates, so it's owned by root. So, and brick runs is root, so it should be okay. So yeah, so the other thing is about how we present to the user the highest M time, especially if data changes across the other other shards, and let's say the base shard did not see any writes, and the maybe the third and the fourth shard saw a write, and the M time is still not updated on the main file. So because VM use case is a single writer use case, we take the liberty of maintaining all this information in the memory itself of the client, and try to calculate the latest time seen on a best effort basis. This is similar to what DHT does. I think DHT also maintains A time, C time, M time in memory in the same way. So what does all of this mean? So lookup, stat, get etc, remove etc, and set etc are directly served from the base file, which means it is still just one network call and you get all the information. So this is just a high level description of how writes work. So the first step would be to create the dot shard directory if it does not exist. Then it would identify the participant shards based on the offset and length that the write has. And then it would create these shards if they don't exist already in parallel. And then probably the last replying response would be the one which would decide the duration of that operation. And we wind the writes basically on all the shards in parallel. We modify the offsets and size as necessary. And then once all write responses are received, we have to update the size and block count through exciter operation. So we do this by actually recording the size seen at the beginning of the FOP, and then we calculate deltas. We get the deltas from the bricks actually. POSIX translator. We make POSIX translator take a mutex lock, do a stat first, then do the write, then again do a stat. So whatever delta you see between the first stat and the second is what you would respond with to the client, and sharding would add up all these numbers and then finally wind a set exciter basically to modify the file size and block count. We also do some in-memory caching of the file size and block size, block count, because it's again a single writer use case, so we don't have to really worry about somebody else changing these values while this and this mount doesn't know. So how are renames and hard links handled? So both FOPs operate only on the base file. So because the GFID of a file is constant even though you rename it, so we don't have to do anything to the GFID dot block count files. They can remain as they are. So we just rename the main file, which means it's again a single network call operation. Okay, so interoperability with existing cluster features. So geo replication and sharding work thanks to the efforts of Kotresh. So that is something we support. And even theoretically, if you think about it, it seems like it should work fine with other features as well, such as bitrot detection, tiering, etc. Because again, because of this architecture where any translator below sharding would see them as normal files, so it would actually do the bitrot detection on individual shards as if they are created by the application itself. So it wouldn't know anything about what this file is, so it should work fine, although we haven't tested it. Features that may not work readily with sharding, one thing for sure is quota, because now all the additional shards are created on dot shards, so the main the parent directory of the file wouldn't witness any of the writes, so it would not be aware of any increase in the size. So quota and snapshots, because write is not atomic, so when the write is in flight and you take a snapshot, you don't know what behavior you can expect, so these things may not work. So yeah, future sharding for general purpose use cases. This is okay, so I think recently Niels, Vijay and I also had this thread on Gluster mailing list about deprecating striping and moving on to sharding and making it fully supported. So towards that, we'll have to fix this. We actually reached out to all those users who had reported bugs against striping long ago to ask them what else they would what they were actually wanting to use striping for. Most of them had moved on and they had even changed jobs, so they didn't even care. So, but yeah, I even asked about this in Gluster users last December. So the only things we can think of right now are storing log files. Maybe when they grow in size, we can actually move them, shard them so that you can utilize the space. So what are the main problems with general purpose sharding? So if you have multiple writers case that you want to support with sharding, consistency and performance trade-off is something we need to solve, because if you try too hard to keep everything consistent, I don't think you'll leverage the benefits of distributing the file into multiple pieces. So yeah, and for consistency, we need to keep writes atomic, and the size and block count being something that is stored on the main file, we need to, even though the other piece files can be written to parallelly, in the end, you still have to do the file and block count update, which will require some kind of locking to make sure that it does not go bad. So and m times again should reflect the highest value. And truncates and appending rights are the ones that actually we still not solved. This is still work in progress, by the way. So what are some of the ideas we've been considering so far? Well, fault tolerance and recovery, we tried to solve in the initial iteration of sharding. We even sent a mail on GlusterDevil with the design, and I think Jeff and Sham also reviewed that, but it seemed like too much of an overkill to try to ensure fault tolerance, and it seemed like too much work to put all this into sharding, because especially if you have replicated setup, which most people do, it may not really benefit much, and it would probably even worsen the performance. So yeah, how do we want to solve it? We want to try to avoid locking as far as possible. So okay. If two writes are on different shards, we can wind those two writes from different clients in one step. We don't have to worry about atomicity. But if they spread across multiple shards, then we don't want interleaving of those two shards. So for example, if one client is writing A at the tail end of the first shard and B at the top of the second shard, and the other is writing C and D on the same regions, we don't want to end up with AD or BC. We only want either AB or CD to be present at the end of the writes. So how can we solve that? So one of the things we are considering is the transaction framework which is Zavi's idea. This is to prevent locking. AFR already takes locks basically, so if sharding also starts taking locks, then it's only going to worsen the performance. So if we can have a common domain where we can do the locking, and AFR and DHT and sharding, all of them can use the same lock, then that is something which will keep the performance to what it is. It won't worsen the performance if sharding also takes locks with this infrastructure. So yeah, this is one more thing we're considering. It's probably too early to talk about it, but I'll just in the worst case probably we'll have to have a server side translator which will only manage the size update. So if a client can give the server side translator information about what was the last seen size that it before its write, and then what are the offset and length of its write, it can probably figure out by how much to make the change in the size and block count, etc. What about C time and M time? So we obviously cannot look up all the 1,000 shards to gather the C time, M time every time there's a stat or some such thing. So we'll probably have to store that in the form of an exciter only on the main file again. So that is, I think, again, Zavi had sent a mail about this some time ago. But this is a problem that multiple layers need to solve, not just sharding. I think even EC and AFR will need to solve this at some point.
I'm so sorry.
Yeah.
I need to keep moving.
Okay.
Might that answer the problem with
just two more points.
Okay.
So compound flops, I'm not really sure if the two operations that we want to compound into one fall on the same file, then probably we can, but most probably that won't be the case for sharding. And for counting the blocks, maybe we'll have to have a bitmap like implementation to make sure it's accurate. At the moment it is not actually. So or maybe a more space efficient version of bitmaps like Bloom filters. So yeah, I'm done, unless you have questions.
Two questions. So as we do this, you can come up and get set up.
I'm not sure whether I
one second.
Solve it correctly or not.
I'm coming to you with the mic. Hold on. Go and get set up.
In the demo, what you showed when you were listing down the dot shards,
mm-hmm.
I saw that in the second break you had only one entry, only one shard entry, whereas in brick 1 and brick 3 you had multiple entries.
Mm-hmm.
My understanding is it should be distributed across.
I think it's based... Huh, he wants to answer.
And so I didn't get it with that. Why can you use it only for VM images, and how do you make sure that it kicks this analysis and kicks in only for VM images? And if it's quite
a so VM images is a single writer use case, so which will work readily as of now without any kind of locking. If there are use cases which have multiple writers to the same file, the last thing that we do in this in every write, which is size update, has to be done atomically, so which is a global exceptor. I mean, all writes would essentially modify that exceptor. So we don't want, especially for files with holes, right, you will probably end up counting the same blocks twice if there are two writes which write. I can probably explain that to you on paper if that helps.
My question is it kind of an all or nothing type of situation? Like, is the translator waiting until you cross over that threshold before creating the dot shard, or is it doing that for all files?
Sorry, I didn't
get you. So is it all or nothing? Like, is every file sharded? Does every file get a dot shard directory?
No, it's just one single dot shard directory. All.
Right, but if you have a small file.
Like 1 meg in your shard.
Yeah.
In
so this is all or nothing. If the volume sharded, does every single file get the sharding treatment?
No, I think it depends on the block size that you configure. So if it's a 4M, if 4MB is the block size that you configured, and let's say you have some files which only grow till 1M, so they will continue to look like normal files.
Okay, yeah, that was a question. Okay, thanks.
Great. In the interest of time, we're going to have to move on. Okay, turn into a birds of feather. And I haven't seen any birds of feather sessions going on.